Hello learners, today in this module so we are going to discuss about the sampling. So here it is very essential to understand the meaning of sampling, objectives of sampling, importance of sampling, and what are the components when we take a sample for analysis we have to follow during the sampling procedure, and how to implement the sampling plan for solids, liquids and gases. Because any analytical chemist or any analyst will be taking a sample for a particular analysis, and the analysis may be with the objective of qualitative analysis or quantitative analysis or to study the surface chemistry of any material, sampling is going to be one of the important steps for analysis. If we ignore the sampling procedure or if we have not followed the sampling procedure appropriately, definitely you cannot achieve results with accuracy and precision. There will be imprecise and inaccurate results are possible when you follow the sampling procedures randomly without adopting any systematic steps. So in sampling, let us define the meaning of sampling, what are the objectives of sampling, importance of sampling, and what are the design criteria we have to follow during the sampling procedure, and how to implement this sampling plan. Let us discuss one by one. So if you take any analytical procedure for a qualitative analysis or a quantitative analysis, even if you have followed the analytical procedure with utmost care, means you have taken too much of care while designing the sampling plan, while designing the analytical procedure, even if you have completed the analysis with most disciplined way and by following the analytical procedure as such without any variations, you have followed the scientific procedure exactly and you have performed the experiment and you have analyzed the given sample very strictly by adhering to the standard procedures or by maintaining the given experimental conditions as such intact. So even you have used carefully designed analytical method for analysis of the given sample, you might have ended up with the results which are inaccurate or imprecise. Why this inaccuracy or imprecise results are obtained? So despite you have followed the analytical procedure intact without varying even 1% to the overall procedure, say for example pH has to be maintained to around 4.5 or the temperature has to be maintained at 30 degrees Celsius during the analysis of a sample, but you have followed the same procedure but you have failed to obtain accurate and precise results. But the thing is, while collecting the sample or while preparing the sample for analysis, you are not cautious how to follow the sampling procedure to prepare the sample for analysis or how to collect the sample for analysis. So these are associated in the error what you have obtained at the final stage. So the errors associated with the sample are also very important. How the errors are going to be associated with the sample, what type of errors and how the errors are going to be obtained during the sampling. So the error may be due to the collection of the wrong sample for the analysis. Say you will go to the target population, you will not be having any idea where to collect the sample and what type of sample has to be collected for analysis, and how to preserve the sample for analysis. Before you take up the sample for analysis, you may have to preserve it for some interval of time. And during the preservation, you cannot keep the sample as such either in the refrigerator or in the laboratory or in the almirah or somewhere else. So you might have collected the wrong sample. Wrong sample means the sample which is going to be not representative for analysis. Any sample you take soil sample or water sample or blood sample or urine sample or semen sample, whatever the sample you take, any chemical compound you take, any metal you take, any element you take or any material you take, you have to collect the representative sample. And what do you mean by the representative sample? Representative sample should comprise of all those components whatever you require during the analysis. And this representative sample, once subjected for analysis, it should not lead to produce erroneous results. Such a sample you have to obtain. And during the preparation of the sample for analysis, you might have lost the analyte because you will be subjecting the sample for digestion or distillation or extraction steps, because many analytical procedures will be utilizing these analytical procedures or analytical techniques. During the extraction of the analyte from the sample, you will be using organic solvent or inorganic solvent, and you will be varying the pH, or you will be varying the temperature, or you will be using the buffer, you will be using some complexing agents, etc. While doing so, and during the sample preparation, some amount of the analyte might have lost, and this may not be due to negligence of the chemist, or may not be due to negligence of the worker, but also due to unawareness about the loss of analyte during the preparation of the sample. Therefore, the type of the sample needed to be collected and the analytical procedure what we are going to follow to prepare the sample is also very important. So, what is the importance of the sampling? So, sampling can be defined as it is a collection of a proper sample for the analysis by following an analytical procedure, and the sample what you have collected must be representative one, and it should define the composition of the target population. Say for example, you might have collected the soil sample from the land. Land is going to be the target population, and the target population is having soil over the upper surface of the land. So, the soil composition is very important here. What is the sampling procedure you will follow in order to collect the soil sample? That is going to be very important. So, let me demonstrate a simple example how the sampling is going to be very important one. Let me consider a sodium bicarbonate which is labeled by American Chemical Society to contain with 0.001% of iron as an impurity. So, if you take any ACS bottle containing sodium bicarbonate, it will be treated to contain with 0.001% of impurity such as iron. So, you have to compare the label claim. Label is claimed by the American Chemical Society workers. What they have labeled that? The impurity of iron is up to only 0.001%. So, if you take any sodium bicarbonate bottle, say for example, in your laboratory, you will be having 500 gram of sodium bicarbonate bottle. So, each 500 gram of sodium bicarbonate bottle which is labeled by ACS, that is 0.001% of iron is present in that sodium bicarbonate. So, you have to confirm. How do you confirm whether the 0.001% iron is present in the sample, or more is present, or less is present? What you have to do, you have to collect the sample of NaHCO3 or sodium bicarbonate or something else which is same as sodium bicarbonate. So, you have to analyze all the bottles having sodium bicarbonate if we speak in a common way, but it will become impractical. Suppose, for example, you might have purchased sodium bicarbonate samples in 10 lots, and all those 10 lots are not needed to analyze in order to confirm or in order to ascertain whether the 0.001% of iron is present or not. So, what do we do? Because it is not possible to analyze the whole lot, we will collect several samples by following the suitable sampling procedure, and we will analyze the collected sample. In each and every analysis, by following a single analytical procedure for different samples of sodium bicarbonate, we will find out what is the amount of iron present. So, it may be 0.001% from the one bottle, and it may be 0.0012% from other bottle, and it may be 0.0009 from the other bottle. So, totally, you take all the individual values and you calculate the mean value, and the true value, it is denoted by nu here, and this true value is having a confidence interval with the mean, that is x bar plus r minus t into s divided by square root of n. This equation clearly says that the true value means the amount of iron present in sodium bicarbonate bottle which is supplied by ACS is having a confidence interval of x bar plus r minus t into s divided by square root of n, where x bar is the mean value of percentage of iron obtained by individual analysis. So, you have analyzed the given sodium bicarbonate sample for iron. suppose you might have performed 5 trials, 5 measurements, you take the mean of all those 5 measurements and you consider it as x bar. And where s is the standard deviation of all those 5 measurements. So standard deviation can be calculated by using the expression sd is equal to square root of summation of xi minus x bar whole square divided by n minus 1. So, and n here indicates the number of samples you have collected. Suppose if we have obtained 5 sodium bicarbonate bottles or 10 sodium bicarbonate bottles, n is going to be either 5 or 10. So, it is not possible to analyze each and every sodium bicarbonate bottle which are present in your laboratory or which have been purchased from the market, which is supplied by ACS. But instead of doing the analysis of all those production lots, you have analyzed some representative samples and you have confirmed that the true value, that is 0.001%, is lying in between x bar minus t into s divided by square root of n and x bar plus ts into divided by square root of n. So this is how we can ascertain that whether the impurity iron which is present in sodium bicarbonate is up to 0.001% or lesser or greater. So that's how the sampling is going to be very important. So you take any sample for analysis, we should have a stipulated sampling plan. So what do you mean by the sampling plan? Sampling plan is simply a plan that ensures the collection of a representative sample for the analysis. Suppose I am going to be the analyst and I have to analyze the sample for the species present in the sample. It may be qualitative analysis or quantitative analysis or characterization study, whatever it is. So the sample you have collected should be a representative sample, and that must ensure as a representative sample and which must be a suitable for analysis irrespective of the objective of the analysis. So usually as a chemist, what I can say that sample analysis will be done only for 3 purposes. It may be for characterization studies or qualitative analysis, and more importantly quantitative analysis. If you consider a characterization studies means what is present in the given sample. You will be doing that. What is present? Say for example, a material scientist is undertaking an analysis for a freshly collected sample, and he is interested to study the metal characteristics. And what he will be doing, he will collect the sample very freshly, and he will scratch the upper surface of the metal or the sample what he has collected, and he will analyze in the vacuum. So what is the objective of doing so? His intention is not to expose the collected sample to the atmosphere, because characterization study is very important and the material scientist is very important to study the characteristics of that particular metal. Surface chemistry is very important there, and in order to understand the appropriate surface chemistry of the collected sample, he has to make sure that the sample has not been exposed to the atmosphere. Therefore, you need a vacuum. You need a vacuum, and in the vacuum you will pursue the analysis. And if you go to qualitative analysis means what is present in the given sample. We need not to ensure the homogeneous sample or homogeneity of the sample for qualitative analysis. But when we collect a sample from the target population, we have to ensure that each and every object or each and every component present in the sample has been given the inference. Suppose there are 5 to 10 components may be present in a sample, and a qualitative analyst must ensure that what are those 5 to 10 components which are present in the sample. So qualitative analysis will be done with the interest of what are the each and every components present in the sample. The individual components will be taken into consideration. And more importantly, the quantitative analysis. Quantitative analysis is nothing but we will determine the components amount. Each and every component's amounts we will determine. How much of the component present in the sample, that is nothing but the quantitative analysis. The quantity of the analyte or the quantity of the species present in any sample can be determined by quantitative analysis. I am interested here in order to illustrate the sampling plan for quantitative analysis. because in quantitative analysis, the target population may not be homogeneous, or it may be homogeneous. My intention or your intention should be to determine what is the amount of each and every species which is present in the sample. So while doing quantitative analysis, we have to design the sampling plan. How to design the sampling plan? What are the questions we have to raise ourselves while collecting the sample, and what are the steps we have to follow while collecting the sample? These are all very important. So for quantitative analysis especially, you have to design a sampling plan. While designing a sampling plan, you have to pose yourself five important questions. What are those five important questions? Number one, you will reach the target population and you have to decide from where within the target population you have to collect the sample. Suppose you are interested to collect the soil sample, you will go to a land which is having the area of 5 acres, 2 hectares. So within that 5 acres of land or 2 hectares of land, from where exactly you have to collect the sample? This should be the first question. And the second question is, from the target population, what type of sample should be collected? If you go to northern side of the land, you may get wet soil, and if you go to western side of the land, you may get dry soil. Therefore, what type of sample you have to collect? That is also very important. And the sample which you will collect from the northern side may be different from the sample which you collect from the western side, or vice versa. Therefore, what type of the sample you have to collect? Very important. And the next question is, what should be the minimum amount? Whether you have to collect 10 kgs of the soil, whether you have to collect 1 liter of blood from the patient, or you have to collect 5 ml of the blood from the patient, or you have to collect 2.5 liters of seawater for analysis, or 2.5 barrels of seawater from the analysis, what is the volume of kerosene you have to subject for analysis? So you will calculate, and what should be the volume of kerosene you have to collect is the third question. And from the target population, is it enough to collect the only one sample, or many samples are needed to be collected? Because as I explained while giving the example of analysis of sodium bicarbonate, from the production lot, different samples are needed to be analyzed. So in order to do so, we may require many samples. So how many samples we have to collect? And this will be the fourth question. And the last and very important question is, whatever the sampling plan you devise, whatever the sampling procedure you follow, the main intention is the overall variance has to be minimized. We have to minimize the variance, therefore we can increase the precision of the analysis. If the precision is more, accuracy will be always at the higher end, provided we follow the analytical procedure in an appropriate manner. If precision is more, the deviation will be less. If deviation is more, precision will be less. Therefore, these five questions you have to put: from where within the target population you have to collect the sample, what type of sample should be collected, what is the minimum amount of the sample needed to be collected for analysis, and how many samples have to be collected and analyzed, and how can all the overall variance can be minimized. So these are the five questions we have to put while designing a sampling plan. Let us go one question after the other. So where to collect the sample? This is going to be the first question. You will reach the target population, where to collect the samples? So there is a way to collect the sample, and there is a spot to collect the sample. We cannot collect the sample according to our own wish. We must follow some standard guidelines, or we must follow some standard procedures in order to decide the place from where we are going to collect the sample. This will be done in many ways by following the many definite principles, and they follow random sampling, judgmental sampling, systematic sampling, systematic judgmental sampling, stratified sampling, and convenience sampling. Random sampling. As the name is implying here, that random sampling is not an haphazard sampling. Haphazard sampling means this is going to be non-ideal. We do not have any intention while collecting the sample. Therefore, we do not bother about the homogeneity of the sample. We do not bother about the composition of the sample what we are going to collect. That is called as Apozard sampling. Random sampling is different from Apozard sampling. We will not follow any Apozard way to collect the sample in random sampling. But the random sampling is an ideal sampling procedure. Why it is ideal? Because we will collect the sample here without having any bias. So we do not have any prejudice. We do not have any expected bias while collecting the sample randomly. So how do we do with that? How do we do this random sampling? In random sampling, we will divide the target population into equal units, and each and every unit will be numbered sequentially, and we will arrange these numbers into a random table, and we will collect the samples at different units. This is called as random sampling. Say for example, you have to analyze a paracetamol tablet, say Dolo 650 or something else. You arrange 100 Dolo 650 tablets in a series according to individual units, and you pick around 10 to 20 individual units as samples. That is called as random sampling. But you don't have any idea that you have to pick 5th unit or 6th unit or 8th unit or 20th unit, etc. Wherever you want, you can choose the sample, you can pick the sample. That is known as random sampling. The random sampling will not make any assumption about the target population, because we are not aware about the homogeneity of the target population, the components of the target population, or conditions of the target population, etc. So it do not make any assumption about the target population. So in order to analyze a sample which is collected randomly, you may have to collect more samples in order to complete the analysis. So in order to do that, more time is required, and in order to analyze whatever the collected samples, you have to follow the analytical procedure as many number of times, therefore it will become expensive. So this is about the random sampling. So random sampling is not an Apozard sampling. This is an ideal sample collection procedure without having any bias. Here we will divide the target population into equal units, and we will assign the number for each and every individual units, and we will pick the sample randomly from different units. Alright. And the next one is the judgmental sampling. Judgmental sampling is also known as selective sampling. And this is completely opposite to random sampling. In random sampling, we do not have any idea about the target population. But here, we will use the available information about the target population. That's what it is, judgmental sampling. Suppose a chemist or an analyst or a researcher is interested to study the bioaccumulation of polychlorinated biphenyls in fishes. Fishes which are present usually in water, they are aquatic organisms, they are aquatic livings. Therefore, the researchers are intended to study bioaccumulation of polychlorinated biphenyls in fishes. So he has to collect the sample by following judgmental sampling procedure. How does he proceed? The requirement is he has to utilize the available information about the target population. Target population here is fishes. He will divide the fishes into small fishes and bigger fishes. And he also divide the fishes into diseased fishes and non-diseased fishes. On what basis he will divide? Smaller fishes and bigger fishes based on the size. And diseased and undiseased fishes based on their activity, movement. How active the fishes in water? So if fishes are more active, they are not diseased. And if fishes are less active, they might have diseased. So his intention is to collect bigger fishes, because in smaller fishes, they have not grown well, and the tissue present in the smaller fishes will be less, and the intention to do the research may not be completed while collecting the smaller fishes. So what he decides, he will utilize the target population that all those bigger fishes which are present in the water he will collect. And in the meantime, he will ignore collecting the diseased fishes. By the activity of the fishes, if the fishes are moving in water very actively, then he can decide that the fishes are not diseased. If the fishes are not moving actively, then we can come to the conclusion that the fishes are diseased. So by ignoring smaller and diseased fishes, a researcher will collect the moving active and undiseased fishes, bigger fishes for analysis. That's what this is known as judgmental or selective sampling. It will become selective because we have selected the fishes which are larger in size and which are very, very active. This type of sampling is called as judgmental sampling. Next one is the systematic sampling. Here, as the name is implying, we will follow the procedure to collect the sample from the target population systematically. So, the target population is sampled at regular intervals in space or time whenever the composition of the target population is subjected to variation. Whenever the target population's composition is varying and the composition will be different from one time to another time, in such cases we will follow systematic sampling procedure. Suppose, for example, the distribution of dissolved oxygen in a lake is the target we have to analyze. The dissolved oxygen in a lake water we have to analyze. How the distribution of dissolved oxygen is observed in the lake water? Because of the heterogeneity of the water, we have to collect the sample, and while collecting the sample, what is the procedure we have to follow? Systematic procedure we have to follow. The diagram presented here will indicate the target population is the water, lake water. Water is flowing. You have to divide the target population into two-dimensional or three-dimensional grid pattern. Here, the target population has been divided into two or three-dimensional grid patterns. You can observe here, and the dots indicates individual dots or individual units indicating the sampling points for individual units, individual grids. So, these are the places from where you can collect the sample. You have to number these target populations individual grid units while collecting the sample and while preserving the sample. So, you can collect the samples at different individual grid units and you can subject it for analysis for dissolved oxygen level. So, what is the dissolved oxygen level of, at this side, and what is the level of dissolved oxygen at this side, and similarly at different sides of the lake you can determine. Therefore, this is known as systematic sampling. Why do we call it as systematic sampling? Because the target population has been systematically divided into two or three dimensional grid pattern, and the samples have been collected from these individual grids. That's what it is known as systematic sampling. And the other one is the combination of systematic and judgmental sampling. So we will collect the sample systematically by utilizing the available information on the target population. So, judgmental sampling means we will utilize the information on the target population, whatever available, and we will sample. In systematic sampling, we will systematically collect the sampling by following an appropriate procedure. Combination of these two is systematic judgmental sampling. What is this? And this is generally encountered in environmental analysis. You may have to collect water sample, you may have to collect a plum from the landfill, or you may have to collect the air sample, whatever it is. So your intention is to collect the sample, and it must be a representative one, and you must fulfill the sampling plan, and you have to complete the analysis without having any imprecision or inaccuracy. Let me take an example of a landfill. Landfills are serious sources of pollutants nowadays, because the air pollution or water pollution is because of the landfills. Especially in urban areas, the quality of air and quality of river water is going to be very important. So, in this diagram, at this particular corner, there is a landfill. Landfill means it is a place where the garbage has been dumped, and one or the other day that garbage will be burnt. So, otherwise, a plume of waste, it will start to leach into the water source. The landfill will be having the waste, and the plum of waste, plum means cake, and that plum of waste will be involved in the leakage to the landfill, which is having the water flow. You assume the flow of water, water means it is a groundwater. If you keep any garbage over the surface of the earth, then definitely even after raining or with the time, the plum of waste will be started to percolate, and it will be joined to the groundwater. So, groundwater will be polluted. Then who are the sufferers? We are the sufferers because groundwater quality will be impaired. Therefore, we have to reduce the groundwater pollution by avoiding the burning of this garbage or by avoiding the dumping of these garbages into the landfills. So we have to follow appropriate processes. We have to follow appropriate cleaning processes, separation processes, etc. in order to have non-polluted air or non-polluted water. So while doing systematic judgmental sampling, we have to collect the sample of water for analysis from where the groundwater sample has to be collected. Here, different lines have been drawn. 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 lines have been drawn. And these lines are representing the water flow, the axis of water flow. Here, the diagonal flow is assumed as the major axis of water flow. And this diagonal axis has the connection to the landfill. Because this landfill is present in this corner, and from this corner to this corner, the water flow is seen. So, the pollution level of this particular major axis may be larger when compared to other axes, because a plume of waste is leaching from the landfill to the water source here. So what is the assumption to collect the sample? We have to divide this water body into systematic units, and we have to judge that there is a major axis of water which is flowing across the target population through the landfill. So here is the landfill, and this is the major axis of flow of water. So let us collect the water from all these points, these dotted points indicating the sampling points from where we have to collect the sample in this major axis. So similarly, you preserve these samples, whatever you have collected from this major axis, and also you have to collect the samples from other units, and you also preserve them before you analyze. So this is known as systematic judgmental sampling. So in the systematic judgmental sampling, we will collect the sample systematically. That is, we will divide the target population into two or three dimensional grid units, and we will utilize the available information about the target population. What is the available information about the target population here? Here it is. Information is available about the plume of waste, or the waste is leaching into the water which is flowing across the ground through the landfill. This is the information which is available. This type of sampling is known as systematic judgmental sampling. And the other one is stratified sampling. Stratified sampling is also called as judgmental random sampling. Judgmental random sampling. Judgmental means we will use the information available about the target population. We will use the information about the target population, but we collect the sample randomly. So random sampling is an ideal sampling procedure where the sample is going to be collected without any bias, and we do not bother about the homogeneity or heterogeneity of the sample, but the judgmental sampling we will do randomly. What we do here, we will go to the target population and we will conveniently divide the target population into individual discrete units or distinct units or strata. Say for example, you will go to an agricultural land where we have to collect the sample. So you will divide the agricultural land from the one corner, you will divide the target population into individual cakes. It may be rectangular in shape, or it may be spherical in shape, or it may be square in shape, whatever it is. So you will divide the target population into distinct units or strata. Then you will collect individual stratum. All those strata are combined together after analysis. But before analysis, you have to collect each and every individual stratum, and you have to analyze them separately. Once the analysis of individual stratum are over, you will calculate the mean. So suppose you have collected 500 stratum from the agricultural land, or 500 stratum from the air. Suppose the particulate matters are present in the air. One portion you will divide into different units, into distinct units, and you will collect the air sample from each and every unit, and you will analyze it. Then finally, you will calculate the mean. The mean of all those multiple measurements you will report. So this type of sampling is called as stratified sampling. So here the stratums are obtained from the target population, individual strata are analyzed and the mean will be calculated. And while analyzing this, we will obtain the assumption that each and every stratum is homogeneous. The composition of each and every stratum will be same as the overall target population. This is the available information. Say, suppose you are going to analyze the soil of agricultural land, you will not bother about the fertility of the soil, whether the macronutrients are present in the east side or west side, or absent in the east side or west side. You do not bother, but you will have the assumption that the composition of the soil which you have collected from the east side must be same as the composition of the soil which you have collected from the west side, whatever it is. So the composition of each and every stratum is often more homogeneous, you will assume. This is judgmental. This is judgmental. It may be true or it may not be true, whatever it is. So this type of sampling is called as judgmental random sampling or stratified sampling. Why do we call it as judgmental sampling? Because we will assume that the stratum whatever we have collected are homogeneous. One stratum to another stratum, the composition is homogeneous. And the homogeneity of the stratum is same as homogeneity of the overall target population. That is judgmental. Random means we will divide the target population into individual strata or individual distinct units. That is random. But we will randomly pick the sample with judgments, with available information. Such samplings are called as stratified sampling. And the other one is convenience sampling. It is one of the easiest sampling way to collect the sample. Here, the sample size are going to be collected with the intention to minimize the sampling error and the variance. The intention to go for convenience sampling is we have to minimize the sampling error or we have to minimize the sampling variance. Say for example, I have to collect groundwater in order to assess the quality of groundwater. Nowadays, drinking water problem can be solved maximally with the utility of groundwater. So groundwater quality is very important. So how to assess the groundwater quality? We have to collect the groundwater. How to collect the groundwater? From where the groundwater has to be collected? Suppose you go to your village or you go to your area where the working wells are available. Pipe wells are available. If there are no wells are available, you have to plan to dig a well, bore well, and once the water is started to come out from the bore well, you have to drill the bore well and you have to collect the sample. If there are bore wells are available, you have to utilize the available bore wells and you have to collect the sample. So that is for our convenience. For our convenience, we may utilize the available bore wells, or if there are no bore wells are available, we may drill one new bore well or two new bore wells or three new bore wells to collect the sample. That's what it is called as convenience sampling. So in convenience sampling, the samples are collected according to our convenience. Whether you have to use this bore well or that bore well doesn't matter. You can collect the sample from any bore well. So collection of the sample is very important. How to collect the sample? Conveniently. The procedure should be very convenient to you. You have to withdraw blood sample from a patient. Whether you collect the blood sample from the right hand or left hand, whatever it is, that is to your convenience. You may withdraw blood sample from the finger, you may withdraw blood sample from the shoulder, you may withdraw blood sample from the stomach, wherever. That is convenience. Right? So this type of sampling is called as convenience sampling. So all these things, random sampling, systematic sampling, judgmental sampling, systematic judgmental sampling, strategic sampling and convenience sampling, all these sampling procedures will answer where to collect the sample from the target population. Then the next question of sample design criteria is what type of sample to be collected. Now to answer this question, we should remember about the three terminologies and the three methods what we follow commonly to obtain the samples. What type of sample you have to collect? So if you go to the target population and if you simply pick 10 gram or 100 gram of the sample from the target population, or 5 liters or 10 liters of the sample from the target population, or 5 ml or 10 ml of the blood sample from the patient. Patient is the target population, river is the target population, land is the target population, borewell is the target population, right? So you will grab a sample, you will grab say 10 ml of the blood, you will grab 1 kg of soil from the land. This sample is called as grab sample. What type of sample has been collected? Grab sample has been collected. This is almost called as snapshot of a target population. Means you will go to the target population, it is just like taking a photograph of the target population. Without following anything, without following any procedure, you will just grab the sample from the target population. That sampling is called as grab sampling. And opposite, next to the grab sampling is composite sampling. Composite sampling means you have to compose a sample by combining different grab samples. You might have collected 10 grab samples or 15 grab samples or 500 grab samples. All those grab samples have to be combined together, have to be pooled together. These pooled samples are called as composite sampling. Composition. Composition of the grab samples are known as composite sampling. So, a set of grab samples that are combined to form a single sample is known as composite sample. Okay, if the physical removal of the sample from the target population is possible, then we can follow to collect the grab sample or composite sample, whatever it is. Suppose river water and the homogeneity and heterogeneity is dependent on the temperature, time, etc. for that river water. So we cannot collect the water sample at different intervals of time, and we cannot complete the analysis within the given stipulated time. Means that is due to the impossibility of collecting the water sample at different time intervals. In such cases, what we can do that, we will use a sensor and we will immerse the sensor into the flow of water in the target population itself, and we can measure the instrument you can use. Sensor will be connected to the instrument and instrument will be displaying the resulted readings. So that readings can be utilized to assess the quality or quantity of the sample. So these type of samples are called as in situ sampling. Here the sampling is done within the population without physically removing the sample. So this may be intended or unintended, whatever it is. If the intention is not to collect the sample, we can follow in situ sampling. And if the intention is to collect the sample but impossibility of physical removal of the sample, we cannot follow either grab sampling or composite sampling. In such cases, we will go for in situ sampling. So in situ sampling means we will utilize the target population directly by means of a sensor to assess the quality, character and quantity of the components which are present in the sample. So these three terms, grab sampling, composite sampling and in situ sampling, will answer the question what type of sample to be collected. And the next question is how much of sample to be collected. So now you have the answer from where the within target population you have to collect the sample and what type of samples have to be collected. Now what should be the size of the sample? Sample size is very important. Is it 5 ml? Is it 5 liters? Is it 1 gram? Is it 1 kg? Right? Is it 1 gallon? So all these questions very important. How much sample to be collected? So let me assume a target population. Target population means there may not be necessarily only analyte to be present. Only the species which you are intended to analyze to be present. Apart from the species, many other species also present. So assume the target population having two types of particles, particle of type A and type B. Particle of type A containing analyte of some concentration and particles of type B containing no analyte. So you have target population, say for example, you have river water, and river water you have collected, it is having dissolved oxygen and also it is also having COD. Some amount of the water is having dissolved oxygen along with COD. You are interested with dissolved oxygen or COD. Dissolved oxygen is going to be the analyte and COD is not the analyte. you are intended to analyze the dissolved oxygen. Similarly, you collect the water sample. You are intended to determine what is the amount of chlorine present in water sample, but you are not interested to determine what is the quantity of other components present in water. So analyte is chlorine or chloride or something else. So if the two types of particles are randomly distributed in the water, chloride and other components which are present in the water have been distributed randomly, then whatever the sample you draw from the target population must follow the binomial distribution. You know about this binomial distribution, I don't explain much about this. So suppose you have collected n particles. N particles means while collecting the sample, you do not bother about the particles, but the number of particles present in the sample is n. And out of those n particles, both analyte and other species are present together in the sample. And together there are n particles. So in that n particles, the expected number of particles containing analyte denoted by Na can be equated to Np. Na means the number of particles which are containing analyte is equal to n into p, where n is the total number of particles, p is the probability of the particles contained with the analyte. P is the probability of particles contained with the analyte. Okay, if you have collected so and you have analyzed the sample containing n number of particles with Na number of analytes, and the standard deviation due to the analysis of such sample can be equated with SS is equal to square root of NP into 1 minus P, where N is the total number of particles you have collected, P is the probability of the particles having the analytes A, number of particles of analytes A, and SS is the sampling standard deviation. So the sampling standard deviation is written as SS is equal to square root of NP into 1 minus P. So this is absolute standard deviation. If you write the relative standard deviation for sampling, that is denoted by SR, SSR, absolute standard deviation divided by total number of particles, you will get relative standard deviation. So relative standard deviation of the sampling is equal to absolute standard deviation divided by the total number of particles with the probability of particles having analyte A, NP, that is SSR is equal to square root of NP into 1 minus P divided by NP. If you simplify for N, you will get N is equal to 1 minus P divided by P into 1 by SSR square. For this equation, you just square it. SSR square is equal to N into P into 1 minus P divided by N square P square. Here, out of n square, 1 n will be cancelled because 1 n will be present here. So, SSR square is equal to, SSR square is equal to P into 1 minus P divided by n into P square. So, if you simplify this, n is equal to 1 minus P divided by P into 1 divided by SSR square. So, this is the equation representing total number of particles having the relative standard deviation SSR square and the probability of the particles which are having analyte A, that is denoted by P. If you consider this example for analyzing a target population which has been subjected for collecting the sample of N particles which is containing only 1 into 10 power minus 7% of the population, how many particles must be collected to give a relative sampling variance of 1%? This is the question. Suppose a target population containing 1 into 10 power minus 7% of the population, how many particles have to be collected to give a relative sampling variance of 1%? That is SSR square of 1% you have to obtain. How many particles have to be collected to complete the analysis? This is the question. 1 into 10 power minus 7% means 1 into 10 power minus 9. 1 into 10 power minus 7 divided by 100 means 1 into 10 power minus 9. 1% means 1 over 100 means 0.01. Variance, S square. Standard deviation square is variance. So SSR square in the previous equation here, SSR square is nothing but the variance. So variance, they asked about 1%. 1% means 1 by 100, that is 0.01. probability of having the particles of analyte A is 1 into 10 power minus 7%, that is 1 into 10 power minus 7 divided by 100, that is 1 into 10 power minus 9. If you substitute all those values into this equation, you will get n is equal to 1 minus 1 into 10 power minus 9 divided by 1 into 10 power minus 9 into 1 over 0.01 square. So the number of particles needed to be collected to show the target population of 1 into 10 power minus 7% with the analyte is 1 into 10 power 13. Suppose if you assume you have to collect the sample of 80 grams in order to contain with 1 into 10 power 13. It will become unscientific to analyze whole 80 gram of the sample. 80 gram of the sample is too much to complete the analysis. Sample size is very high. So this is where the sample size is questioning. So we cannot use the whole 80 gram, but we have to concentrate on reducing this 80 gram without compromising with the number of particles. Number of particles to be present in the target population should be 1 into 10 power 13 with analyte A, and the variance should be 1% only. So how to reduce this? Suppose the particles are in spherical shape. Suppose the particles are in spherical shape. We know the equation that mass of any sphere is proportional to radius cube, the radius cube of its radius. Mass of any spherical particle or any sphere is proportional to r cube. You know this. This 80 gram of the sample, you know, 80 gram of the sample is containing 1 into 10 power 13 particles. Each and every particle is spherical in shape. You grind all those 1 into 10 power 13 particles into smaller particles. How you have grinded? You have decreased the particle's radius by a factor 2. The radius of the larger particles have been reduced by a factor 2. Then the mass of individual particle has also been reduced by 2 cube, that is 8. That is 8. Individual particle mass has been reduced by a factor 8. Therefore, 80 gram of the sample has been reduced to 10 grams. 80 by 8 means 10 grams. So instead of collecting 80 grams, to collect 10 power 13 particles, only 10 gram of the sample may be sufficient. So instead of using 80 gram of the sample, you have to use 10 gram by reducing the sample size. So the conclusion from this example is neither the larger sample size nor the smallest sample size is required for analysis. An appropriate sample size must be decided before you go for the analysis, because the sample size is directly linked to the sampling variance. Variance should be minimum. If variance is large, that leads to imprecise results. So you have to be very careful. So without making any compromise with the number of particles or the sample size, you have to subject the sample for sample reduction. That's what, how much sample has to be collected. Instead of 80 grams, you have to collect 10 grams. Instead of 10 grams, you have to collect 5 grams or 0.5 gram, whatever it is. This is about the answer for the question, how much sample has to be collected. And the next one is, how many samples have to be collected? You will go to the target population and you may grab the sample, or you may collect the composite sample, or you may utilize the in situ sampling procedure. How many samples have to be collected? Whatever the samples, whatever the number of samples you have collected, the objective is in order to reduce the sampling variance. Variance should be minimum, means the standard deviation must be minimum. The precision of the result must be maximum. You have to end up the results with utmost accuracy. You know the confidence interval for the sampling error. Suppose the true value is denoted by nu, as I denoted in the very second slide of this presentation. Nu is lying between the confidence interval of x bar minus t into s divided by square root of ns and x bar plus t into s divided by square root of ns, where this is known as confidence interval of the true value, where ss is the sampling standard deviation and NS is the number of samples you have analyzed. If you t is the statistical factor for the given degrees of freedom and the given confidence level, whether it should be at 90% or 95% or 99.5%, whatever it is. So if you simplify for ns, if you simplify for ns, nu minus x bar you will get, nu minus x bar you will get plus or minus t into ss divided by square root of ns. If you square this nu minus x bar, this is nothing but the numerical difference between the true value and the obtained value. Mean is nothing but the obtained value. The numerical difference between the true value and the obtained value, you will get an error. That is denoted by E. So E is equal to t into ss divided by square root of ns after plus or minus. You square this. Nu minus x bar means E. E square is equal to plus or minus t into ss divided by square root of ns whole square is t square into ss square divided by ns. So ns is equal to t square into ss square divided by e square. Here we must concentrate on error. So how many samples have to be collected? You know, the precision of any experiment can be increased by increasing the number of experiments, by increasing the number of measurements. As the number of measurements is increased, the precision is also going to be increased. So infinite number of measurements is going to give you highly precise results. Infinite number of measurements will give you most precise results. For any analytical method, for any analytical procedure, if you follow appropriately, by undertaking as many number of measurements as much as possible, you can obtain the results at the end which are very, very precise. So here also, as you collect the more number of samples for analysis, as you collect the more number of the samples for analysis, the precision will also become very high. If you collect less number of samples for analysis, the precision will be less and the variance will be less, and the final outcome will be the sampling error and the sampling imprecision will also be more. So you have to concentrate on absolute and relative uncertainties as much as possible to reduce during the collection of the sample. Therefore, not only the size of the sample, but also number of samples you have to collect. Suppose you wanted to analyze a soil sample, you have to collect the soil sample from the target population at least 10 to 15. If you analyze a single soil sample, you may not get precise results because error, that is the numerical difference between the true value and the obtained value, will be very high. Error will be high and even the precision will become suffered. So in order to increase the precision, in order to improve the precision, in order to improve the variance of an analytical method or analytical results, you have to increase the number of samples to be collected for analysis. So ns is proportional to ss square and ns is inversely proportional to e square. Therefore, the final conclusion is you have to increase the number of samples to be collected for analysis. Therefore, this difference may be made lower. Nu minus x bar may be made lower by increasing the number of samples, or if you take less number of samples, this difference will become higher. So accuracy will be suffered if you have analyzed very less or limited number of samples, and the difference between these two, nu and x bar, will become lower if you increase the number of samples. So better to use large number of samples for analysis, and you calculate the mean value of such large number of samples you have collected. So that's what, the sample variance may be improved by collecting the larger number of samples, and the relative uncertainty can also be reduced by collecting the large number of samples. And in the meantime, smallest number of samples which leads to produce larger errors, inaccuracies. So these are about the design criteria of collecting the samples. So sampling is very important because we have to obtain a representative sample for analysis. While collecting the sample, we must be very, very careful about the intention for what we are collecting the sample. So we have to design a sampling plan by putting 5 questions ourselves. That is, from where within the target population we have to collect the sample, what type of the samples we have to collect from the target population, how much of the sample has to be collected and how many samples have to be collected, and the overall question of all these four is variation has to be minimized, or in order to improve the variance, how to put the sampling plan in appropriate platform. So thank you very much for listening. In the next module, we shall discuss about the implementation of the sampling plan.